everybody, to another edition of Coffee with Coaches. My name is Pat Lawler, and joining us today is the Director of Track and Field and Cross Country, Gabe Sanders. Gabe, thanks so much for joining us today. Hope you've had a chance to enjoy some of this warm weather. How's everything going?
Well, relatively speaking, I don't know if I've been enjoying the hot weather of it, the swelteringness of it, but we the family have been enjoying some outside time.
Any particular plans, any trips, anything going on?
Well, no, not really traveling, you know, between obviously, you know, COVID and the pandemic, but also my in-laws are halfway between here and the Cape. Okay. So the nice thing is, you know, every couple weekends we've had the opportunity to go down there for a day. They live about a 10-minute walk to the beach by Duxbury Beach. So that's just a nice little like quick getaway, 45 minutes, an hour down the road, which is lovely. And then in addition to that, our vacation includes just outdoor activities, putting the house together, you know, being here for year one. My wife recently bought a giant play set that's equivalent to some stuff that you might see on a playground, since we're not using playgrounds now. So she took it upon herself to bring the playground to us. So that's been a project over the last week and a half. But anything to tucker out the little man.
Yeah, sounds like a few staycations like everyone else. And in this heat, I think maybe even the water at Duxbury Beach may have warmed up enough to go in.
Yeah.
It's usually pretty cold down there. So much has happened since I've last seen you. The pandemic obviously canceled seasons, ongoing protests against police brutality, and discussions of systemic racism. What have the last few months been like for you, and what are some of the main issues you are dealing with when it comes to trying to coach during these unprecedented times?
Well, I think something that, you know, we always preach to the athletes themselves, and a phrase that, you know, I don't think ever gets old, is control the controllables. You know, control what you can control. And, you know, something that I've leaned into is the phrasing, you know, just control the four walls of your house. If you can control the four walls of your house, you'll have a pretty good grip on your life. And things that you can control are, you know, in relation to, you know, the, I don't want to say uprising, but the awareness, the newfound awareness and engagement in the systemic racism that America faces by black America, police brutality, things of that nature, something that I've really appreciated seeing in our coaching staff and our athletic department is the engagement of our young people, especially on the track team, that are participating not only in protests in a healthy way, where obviously mask wearing, social distancing whenever possible, having good practices, but, you know, creating initiatives, including, you know, voting rights, including engagement of local politics, including engagement of just growing awareness of how the system actually works, how it's so easy to pigeonhole isolated incidents and not take a step back or three and look at the broader picture of the system that led to those incidents. You know, there's a reason that, you know, you look at certain areas of the country that have high crime rates. Well, there's a correlation of poverty. There's a correlation of a lack of resources. And that didn't just happen. You know, the things somehow set up that set those pieces in motion. So it's honestly really encouraging to see the engagement of the youth, honestly, beyond the Twitter sphere nowadays. You know, it's not just about retweets, but it's about what are you actually doing offline to make change, which is really, really uplifting to see in our young people. And as far as the pandemic is concerned, you know, you just have to be available for the student athletes whenever you can, whether that's a Zoom call, a phone call, a text message here or there. I think our coaches have done a good job, you know, just facilitating, you know, keeping the athletes busy. Our strength staff has done a phenomenal job keeping them engaged and making sure that they have opportunities to work outside of a weight room. And, you know, I know Coach Robin has done a phenomenal job. Our strength coach has done a phenomenal job providing resources for our young people. So all we need to do right now is just stay in motion and be prepared for our opportunity when we come back.
Yeah, it's been amazing to see the engagement by the student athletes. And I couldn't agree with you more. Their interaction in education with the university has been doing has been been very impressed, and a little bit of a silver lining to what these times have been like. So you're talking about student athletes that are already on your team. Early in the year, you announced an incoming class of 2024. That class will have over 30 recruits. That's a big class. Tell us a little bit about the recruitment process, what went into it, and what your goals going forward are for that class.
Yeah, I mean, I'm kind of getting chills just thinking about that recruiting class. I'm really, really proud of the work our staff did and our entire program did, because everybody had a hand in it, from the coaches to the student athletes to the support staff, to facilitate a well-rounded program, because that's who we want to be. We want to be all-inclusive here. Something that we've been preaching is, you know, I'm the director of the program and I'm a sprints coach by trade, most recently in my career, but this isn't going to be a sprints program. And it's not going to be a distance program. It's not going to be a jumps program. It's not going to be, a throws program. It's going to be an elite program. You know, we're going to cover all our bases. And, you know, the goal set out for our coaching staff is, let's find some high quality individuals that we feel can create a baseline for the future moving forward. So people that really recognize the opportunity that Boston University is, you know, as an elite academic institution that will set you up for the rest of your life, an institution that via its academic resources, via its network, via its name visibility around the country and around the world, has the potential to shape your family tree for generations to come. But also, don't feel like they want to shortchange themselves on the track. They actually want to have that same mentality on the track, in the circle, on the runway, that, again, want to be elite, take it to the nth degree. You know, find those diamond in the rough type people that really recognize that. And we were lucky. We found about 30 of them that recognize that opportunity and are excited about it. So the thing I'm most proud about this class, it's probably the most well-rounded class as far as event areas, probably in the last however many decades, honestly. You know, we brought in a strong contingent of distance athletes, including a young man that was the top-rated cross-country runner in Canada. We brought in a number of throwers that are top-tier throwers. We brought in, you know, one of the best sprinters out of the state of Texas, and in turn, one of the best sprinters in America, who won the Texas A&M High School Invite, the bit like the most prestigious high school invite in the state of Texas during the indoor season. I mean, we brought in the top junior multi-event prospect from the UK. You know, we brought in probably someone that was a favorite to win the Division III national title in the high jump. I mean, we brought in some really high-level kids, and we brought in some kids that, while on paper are not there yet, our coaching staff did a phenomenal job recruiting with their eye and saying, hey, this person is here, but I see a huge ceiling ahead of them.
Yeah, in writing the press releases for that class, it was so noteworthy how many different types of athletes are coming in, multis, throws, jumps, sprinters, cross country, distance. It was it's such a well-rounded group, and I'm sure you're excited to kind of get your hands on them, get them on campus, and get them going. But you don't know if that's going to happen. It's end of July now, heading into August. Kids will be coming back to school campus in a few weeks. What are your thoughts on the impending announcements, the indoor season? What are you trying to prepare for? What's your mindset going into the fall?
We come up with as many scenarios as we can. We plan with the information we have before us, and we shift with the information that comes. We just adapt. I haven't really sweat it, to be quite honest. I don't know, call me weird or too laid back, but again, I don't have control over, you know, this disease, this pandemic, you know, but what I can do is I can actively listen to actual experts in the field. I can listen to what epidemiologists are saying, what virologists are saying, you know, what people that are well versed in this field. And that's what makes me feel good about being at Boston University, is we have those people, world renowned people, on our staff on Commonwealth Avenue. So of all places in the country, of all universities to be a part of, I feel the most at ease about being a part of this university, because, you know, they're going to be as up to date as possible on a monthly, weekly, daily basis with what needs to be done. And as far as competition, you know, we're going to compete when we compete. We'll be prepared for opportunity when it comes. But, you know, something that we shared with the student athletes recently is really we have three priorities for when they get back to campus, and they're in rank order. And number one, first and foremost, is health and safety. Is their health and safety when they're on campus, making sure that they can live a healthy, safe life, you know, free of COVID, and making sure that they're not sick or they spread it to other people. And then number two, you know, not too far behind is functionality. We also want them to be able to live a functioning life on a daily basis, to be able to, if they choose and feel comfortable, go to and fro from class, you know, for us to be able to functionally practice. If that's groups of 5, 10, or 15, whatever that protocol is, we'll work with it. We'll make it work. If I have to have a dozen practices in a day, I'll do that. You know, so number two, let's have a functioning daily life. And then number three, a very distant number three right now in the immediate future, is being competitive. Because here's the thing. If we take care of number one and number two, and we also adhere to our values as a program and as a department, which is be elite, be excellent, become the standard, that'll take care of itself. I'm not worried about that piece. But what I'm concerned about is the holistic experience of our student athletes and our staff members. And we will be competitive because we're very good at what we do, but we got to do it in the right way.
That is a great mindset to have. So many people in college athletics, especially, so competitive and control freaks, just have to sometimes say, this is out of our control and there's nothing we can do. It's good to hear you put that in perspective for us. Well, thanks, Gabe, for joining us on another edition of Coffee with Coaches. I wish you well. Stay cool, and we'll talk soon.
Thanks so much, Pat. Take care.
Take care.